Welcome to EPG Pathshala Philosophy. I am Satchidanand Mishra from Banaras Hindu University in the Department of Philosophy and Religion. I am working as a professor there. I am going to present you the paper, the module, Technical Terms in Navyanyaya 3, and the course is Logic 2nd. And the writer of this module is Professor Ujjwala Jha. The objective of this module is to introduce some concepts related to relation and how those concepts are useful in the understanding of Navyanyaya, the way of definitions Navyanyaya discusses, formulates. So in our last chapters, last modules, we have discussed the nature of relation, the kinds of relation, though two basic kinds of relation, direct relation and indirect relations. And thereafter, we have also discussed vrittiniyamak sambandh, occurrence exacting relation, and non-occurrence exacting relations. And now we are going to discuss some concepts which are useful in the understanding of all these relations. And one of them is pratyogita and another is anuyogita, and some more concepts will be introduced here. Anuyogita, pratyogita, nirupya nirupaka bhava, avachhedakata, visheshyata, visheshanata, vishayata, vishayita, and some relations which were not discussed in last modules, and those relations would also be introduced in this module, like kalik relation, tempo, that is temporal relationship, and visheshanata, visheshyata, vishayata, etc. So all these will be introduced in this module, and the objective of this module is to make you acquainted with these ideas and these basic concepts. So we cannot understand any relation unless we understand the idea of pratyogita and anuyogita. So these two are very basic ideas, because whenever we have the question about a relation, when we are talking about a relation, we can say different way. We ask the question, we give statements like X and Y are related, and Y and X are related. And there is another way to say it, that X is related to Y and Y is related to X. So what is the good way to communicate the relations? And the Nayayikas are of this opinion that it is wrong to say, it would not be a proper way to saying, to describing a relation when we say that A and B are related and or X and Y are related. Rather, we would have to say that X is related to Y or Y is related to X. The point is that according to Navyanyaya, the relation is pointing to another, and it is starting from one and going to another. And therefore, when there is a relation, like if there is a pot on the ground, or there is a berry in the pot, in those cases, we say that one is the substratum and another is superstratum. One is anuyogi and another is pratyogi. But how do we understand that which one is anuyogi and which one is pratyogi? And here, in order to understand this arrow of relation, we have to posit some questions. And there are two basic questions. And if we understand the answer of answers of these questions, if we can pick up the answers of these questions, we can understand that which one would be the pratyogi and which one would be the anyogi. Suppose the example I have taken here, the pot is on the ground, and in this case there is a relation between pot and ground, and the relation is contact. So we would ask about this relation, that whose relation this is, and the answer which is provided here is would be pratyogi. And here if we ask the question, whose relation, whose contact is there in the ground, the reply would come naturally that this is the contact of pot. So pot is the pratyogi. And where is the relation? And the reply would be that the relation is in the ground. So here the question, the answer comes to second question, that which one is anyogi. So in this case the pot would be pratyogi and the ground would be anyogi. So pratyogi and anyogi would become very clearly visible if we analyze every relation in the light of these two questions. And therefore many times it is said that yasya sambandha sa pratyogi, whose relation is this, that is the pratyogi, and where there is the relation, that is anyogi. And from this idea comes another idea, and accordingly the Nayayikas point out that these two are translated in English as base relatum and counter relatum and base relatum. Pratyogi is the counter relatum and anyogi is the base relatum. So the arrow of relation is going from counter relatum to the base relatum. So many times there are so many relations formulated, and those relations which are formulated except those relations which we have discussed in last modules. There are many relations formulated and discussed and accepted, and those relations are such relations where the property of base relatum is taken as the relation. So like if we take sonness, putratva, so putratva would become a relation of father, because father is there, in father there is fatherhood, and in putra there would be sonhood. So sonhood is the relation of father to the son. And here in this case, however, it was not discussed in our last modules that fatherhood or sonhood would be a kind of relation. But any property of a base, any base relatum could be understood as a different relation at all. And if that property is taken, that property related to that base relation, base relatum, therefore the base relatum would be anyogi. And the question would arise that if I am talking about this, there is putratva, there is sonhood, so the question would arise that whose sonhood is there? Who is the father of that person? That suppose I say that X is the son of. So the question would arise, whose son? So whose son is there? And the answer is provided, and the answer is coming to understand the idea that who is the pratyogi of this relation. So the person, if I say that X is the father of Y, then Y, in Y there is sonhood, and in X there is a father. X, in X there is a fatherhood. So fatherhood would be the relation of Y to X, and sonhood would be the relation of X to Y. So in this case the arrow of relationship could be understood very easily, taking into consideration these questions, we can understand without any difficulty that who is the pratyogi and who is the anyogi. And in order to understand the concept of relation, these two ideas, pratyogi and Anuyogi are very important. Counter relatum and base relatum are very much important in understanding all relations. Without them, we cannot understand the concept of relation at all. And there will be always a question that why do you say that X is present in Y and Y is not present in X? And the Nayayikas have a very simple answer that actually X is present in Y because the arrow of this relation is going to Y. Therefore, X is present in Y. And if the arrow of relation were going to X, we could say very clearly that Y is present in X. So, the idea of relation is such kind of that where two things are not related with each other, where one could be present in another and another could also be present in first one. So this is not the case here. But the arrow is going to direct it to Anuyogi and it is starting from Pratyogi. And we can remember that in our last modules we have understood that in direct relation which started from Swa, and this Swa, the self, is there to indicate that which one is the Pratyogi of that relation, and this is the Pratyogi of that relation, and where it is going, where it is pointing to, that is the Anuyogi, that is the base relatum of that relation. So these two ideas, Anuyogi and Pratyogi, and because of Anuyogi and Pratyogi, Anuyogita and Pratyogita, these two ideas come into play, and these two ideas are very much necessary to understand the concept of relation at all. Another point is there, Nirupya Nirupaka Bhava. This is also very interesting and very important concept in Nyaya. Nirupya Nirupaka Bhava, describer, describedness. So this describer and describedness is a kind of relation where this can be understood as a kind of relation also. So here in this case where I have taken that father and son, the X is father of Y. So I have taken this example, X is father of Y. So in Y there will be sonhood and in X there will be fatherhood. So but this fatherhood cannot be there if it doesn't describe the sonhood in Y. Because and if there is sonhood in Y, this sonhood describes fatherhood in X. So both these sonhood and fatherhood describe each other. So if you are starting from fatherhood and going to son, there would be, we would say that this fatherhood describes, fatherhood is describing the sonhood which is present in Y. And if we are moving from that side, we would say that the sonhood which is present in Y is describing the fatherhood which is present in X. So in this case, one is described and another is described. So describer, another is described. But these points are changed. It is not the case that which one is describer, that would always be the describer, and which one is described, that always would be the described. But this picture gets changed many times, and if you are moving from here, then the describer would be the describer would be X and described would be Y. But if you are moving from Y, the scenario will change and the describer would be Y and described would be X. So in this case, in this way, we can say that the fatherhood which is present in X is described by sonhood which is present in Y. And in the completely opposite way, we can say that the sonhood which is present in Y is describing the fatherhood which is present in X. So describer, described, describerness and describedness are to be understood in this case, in this way, and they can be formulated as relation also. So this is the idea, and between describeness and describerness, this is called nirupya nirupak bhava in Sanskrit. So this nirupya nirupak bhava is very important in understanding the concept of relation, because there are many concepts, many relations which are taken as a relation only because those are property of base relatum. So if there is a property is taken of base relatum and understood as a relation, then these two must be understood. Without describer and describedness, those that relation cannot be understood. So here we can take this example. Kunde badram kundam badarvat. So here kund means pot and badar means berry. So in kund, in pot, there is a berry. So here between berry and kund, there is a relation contact, and this contact is there. Contact is locating to the pot, because pot is becoming anuyogi, and badar, this is to say berries, are becoming counter positives, counter relatums of this relation. So if the contact is taken as a relation, here in this case berries are becoming counter relatums and the pot is becoming base relatum. So in this case there is a adheya, one is adheya and another one is adhar. What is the substratum, what is the locus that is adhar, and what is present there, that is to say berries are present in the pot, so those berries are adheya. So in berries there is adheyata, superstratumness, and in pot there is, that is substratum. So substratumness is there. So this substratumness, adharata, is there. So between adharata and adheyata there is describer describedness, between nirupya nirupak bhav. One is, if you are talking, this is the adhar, this is the substratum, the question would arise, whose substratum this is? And when you are saying that this is superstratum, the question would arise, whose superstratum it is? Therefore, whenever you are talking about adhara adheya bhava, karya karana bhava, if you are saying that this is the cause and this is the effect, so the question naturally would arise, whose effect this is and whose cause this is. So when these questions arise, those are actually questions related to describer describedness or base relatum and counter relatum. So sometimes, if this is a there are cases of relations which we have discussed in our last modules, like contact or inherence or self-linking relations. In those cases, these questions would be about base relatum and counter relatums. But if these are not there, if the question is coming about something else, which is the about the property of base relatum, and if the property of base relatum is taken as a relation, then these questions are coming, then these questions are answered taking the shelter to describer describedness. So these are points, and thereafter there is another thing, sadrishya. Sadrishya, similarity. Similarity is understood as another relation, because when we are talking about similarity, it is always sapratyogika padartha. There must be a pratyogi, there must be a counter relatum to similarity, because when we say that something is similar to, the question would arise, if I say that X is similar, the question arises, to which? So if I say any person is similar to the moon, So here the moon is counter relatum and the person is base relatum. So there are two relatums, base relatum and counter relatum. So if we are taking similarity, because when we take similarity, there must be a counter relatum. Without counter relatum, we cannot talk about similarity at all. So if there is a chandra sadrishya mukha, there is a similarity in mouth of moon. We say many times, we praise someone, say that you are looking like a moon. So when we say that you are looking like a moon, so moon is counter relatum, and the person you are talking to is actually a base relatum, anuyogi. So there are two points to remember in this case, that whenever you are talking about similarity as a relation, there must be one pratyogi and there must be an anuyogi. This is to say, one is base relatum and another is counter relatum. So comparison when is made, these two are involved. Without them, a comparison is not possible at all. Another point and another relation is there, and this relation is formulation of Navyanyaya philosophy, that is Paryapti Sambandha, the relation of inclusion. And the Paryapti Sambandha can be understood taking one simple example, if we are to understand the concept of Paryapti. There are two people, and suppose there is a big load, heavy bag, and one is not capable moving that bag. Two person are able to move that bag. Two person can carry that bag, but one is not powerful enough to carry that one. So if it is asked, who is carrying the bag, whether A is carrying the bag or B is carrying the bag, these two are carrying the bag, and A and B, A is a person and B is a person, and both are taking together the bag to carry. One is not able to pick it up, but both are able to pick the bag and carry the bag. So who is the carrier of that bag? You have to answer in the way that both are carrying the bag. So this is the idea of Paryapti relation. Paryapti is such kind of relation which cannot be present in one, but it can be present in more than one. So if I say that there are two things, so two books are there. So two books are there, so the two-ness is a number. According to Nayayikas, two-ness is a number. So if it is asked, where there is two-ness, in first one or in second one, which one is first and which one is second, whom you are considering second, second is something different actually, but two, if you are talking two are both of them, if you are referring to, you can say that both of them are two, but one is not two. So therefore in Sanskrit there is an expression that I am nad dvau kintu dittovan. This one is not two, but this one is having the property ditva. So this is to say, two-ness is a number, and number is a quality. And according to Nyaya and according to Vaisheshika, a quality, between quality and substance, there is a relation inherence. So this ditva, if taken as a proper quality, it will be present in both of them by the relation inherence. But if you ask whether it is good to say that one of them is two, then Nayayikas would say no, it is not right to say, it would be wrong, because one is not actually two, but one is one member of those two. So actually both of them are two, one is not two at all. So two-ness is number, and two-ness is present in both of them, but without leaving any one of them. It will be present in both of them at the same time. So this is the logical necessity, and it is the point to remember the idea of paryapti. Suppose you are taking three things or more than three, four, five, six, and so on. So in all these cases, this idea of paryapti, this paryapti relation has to come into play, and without this paryapti, all these issues which are related to it would not be considered good. So this is idea of paryapti. And if we are understanding the idea of paryapti, the relation of paryapti, so there is also another point to memorize, to understand, and that is, what is the delimiterness existing by property relation? And this is called the idea of avachhedakata. Because if you are taking paryapti and if you are taking the nyaya way of philosophizing, the Navyanyaya language, you have to understand another very important concept, that is avachhedakata, delimiterness. And this is the idea delimiterness. When you are talking about a relation, when you are talking about an absence, and one more point here to understand about pratyogita and anuyogita. I have introduced just the idea of pratyogita and anuyogita, which are related to relation, but the pratyogita and anuyogita can be related to absence also. Because if there is an absence, there is also a question whose absence is. And if the question is answered that the absence of part, the question would come that where there is the absence of part. So where there is the absence of part, the place is actually anuyogi, that is the base relatum, as in case of sambandh. So it is very simple, in the same pattern it can be understood as in case of sambandh, there was the question whose relation is. Here we ask the simple question whose absence is, and the answer is provided, that would become pratyogi, that is the count. And here we have another term we coined in English, another term, counter positive. However, it is not completely good translation, but it can do. So counter positive, and there is a base of that, the adhikaran of that absence, that is known as anuyogi. So anuyogi and pratyogi both are introduced as in case of sambandh. In the same way, both of them are introduced in absence, in the case of absence also. So in talking about sambandh, talking about absence, we need delimiter. Without delimiter, it would be in confusion. We cannot understand clearly. So you can say that the idea of delimiter is the backbone of technical language of Navyanyaya. So in technical language of Navyanyaya, they introduced the idea of avachhedakata, that is delimiter. So when you are saying that there is no part at all, there is the absence of part, so here the question would arise that which part is actually the counter positive of that absence, whether the red part, whether the blue part, whether the white part, or some else. So you cannot say that white pot is the counter positive of that absence, and blue pot is not counter positive of that absence, and neither you can say that red pot is the counter positive of that absence, but white pot is not the counter positive of that absence. But you have to reply that all those pots are actually counter positives of that absence. So how could you say that all parts are counter positives of that absence? Because we are talking about the absence of part, we are not talking about the absence of parts. And here in introducing the idea, you are saying that those all parts are actually the counter positives of that part, that absence. So the point is that when we say that all those parts are counter positives of that part, that of sense, here that count, that counter positive part, in all those counter positives, in all those parts, there is counter positiveness, and that counter positiveness is delimited by a partness. Therefore, this is the idea of delimiter. So without this delimiter, it would not be possible to convey the meaning as clearly it can be conveyed. So this is also very interesting point. So whenever we talk about the absence, when we talk about the relation, so this idea of delimiter is very important. Another thing to note about these concepts which we are talking about, there are some relations like Vishayata. Vishayata is a kind of relation. Vishayata is another kind of relation. So as I had explained just a few minutes earlier, that the property of base relatum is taken as a relation. So if there is a vishaya, vishaya means object. So the property of object is vishayata. So vishayata would can play the role of a relation. So what is the vishayi? Vishayi is the cognition. So if vishayi, cognition is the vishayi, so in cognition there is vishayita. So vishayita can also play the role of a relation. So if you say that there is a vishayata or there is a vishayita, so vishayita would be there of vishaya to, vishayita would be there of vishaya to cognition, and vishayata would be of cognition to vishaya, to object. So when you are talking about the relation of object to cognition, there would be the relation vishayita, and if you are talking about the relation of cognition to object, that would be vishayata. So these two are very important relations introduced by Navyanyayikas. And another special, another kind of relation which is known actually, which is, which was discussed in last module, last modules, visheshanata, that is known as swarupa sambandha. Visheshanata means qualificandness. As if there is a cognition, in that cognition something is understood as a qualifier, something is understood as a qualificand, and something is understood as a relation. So that cognition is useful in our behavior, in our daily life. There is a visheshanata, and whatever is qualifier, there will be a qualifierness, and whatever is qualificand, there will be qualificandness, and whatever is the relation, there would be sansargata. So sansargata, visheshanata, and visheshyata, these can also play the roles of different relations. So these are also relations which are possible to say. Another very important relation is kalik. Kalik, it means that temporal relation. Temporal relation means that if two things are present in the same time frame, we can say that one is present in another by the relation kalik, by kalik relation, by temporal relation. And if both are not present in the same time frame, you cannot say that one is present in another. Suppose X and Y, suppose Ram and Ravan, both belong to the same time frame, so you can say that one Ram is present in Ravan by the relation, by this temporal relation. All those people which are living now, they can be present in one in another, they can be present everywhere by the relation, by this temporal relation. But suppose you are talking about Akbar and Barack Obama. Akbar was much earlier, and they both don't belong to the same time frame. Therefore, there cannot be any kalik relation, any temporal relation. So temporal relation is possible only between two things which are related to the same time frame, which are existent in the same time frame, and if those are not existent in the same time frame, there is no possibility of temporal relationship. So these are relations which we have discussed, and to sum up, in this module we have discussed that how these concepts, the concept of pratyogita, concept of pratyogita anuyogita, and the concept of describer, describedness, are useful in the process of explaining these ideas, the process of explaining the ideas of relation, in understanding the idea of relations, and also the concept we have discussed, visheshanata, visheshyata, and temporal relationship, vishayata, which is the relation of object to the visheshan, which is the relation of cognition to the object, and vishayita, which is the relation of object to cognition. So all these we have discussed. The idea of avachedakta, that is the delimiterness, we have discussed in this module, which is very useful in understanding all the Navyanyaya definitions, because every definition of Navyanyaya cannot be understood without taking into consideration the idea of delimiterness. So the students, thank you all for listening to me.